Okay, this is a 1994 Harley with I think a 97 Sportster engine. It's a Sportster bike. Now, I rode it to work a couple of days for the first 2 days, and it went absolutely perfectly. Didn't miss a beat. And then what happened was I went to start off one morning and it wouldn't take off. It had just splutter. So that is to say that the previous day was perfect. This has happened, you know, it happens fairly regularly that you'll get up one morning and the same bike won't work, you know, as well. So I was missing, I don't think it's fuel, I think it's an electrical problem. It sort of chugs and splutters. It's not an easy diagnosis because although it chugs and splutters, then it'll also correct itself, it'll also run perfectly, and then it'll go through this chugging and spluttering and even backfiring, and then it comes good and it works properly. The heat of the engine doesn't have any bearing on the engine's performance, the way it runs. You know, it can chug and splutter just after taking off, and it can also work perfectly and then go through a sort of a spluttering process. So okay, so the morning that it wouldn't you know, run properly, and I left it behind, when I got back from work I found that one of the spark plugs wasn't working, one of the cylinders wasn't firing. So I got two new spark plugs and it seemed to run good, but then there was a problem with spluttering when I used the bike the next day. I don't think it's fuel because it's got a new tank and it seems to have a new petcock, new fuel tap. Although that would definitely be something worth testing if it's found not to be an electrical problem. These are the spark plugs that came out of it. They're Screaming Eagle, and it could well be the original spark plugs. They've got a very fine point on the top. I don't know whether you can see that or not. You'll notice there that on the right hand side that there's no gap. I'm pretty sure I dropped it. I'm fairly sure that that's why there's no gap. I dropped it on the cement floor, and that was a normal gap before I dropped it. I've installed NGK DCP R7E. It's a good bike, by the way. It's a delight to ride. I really enjoy riding it and handles really well. People in general like it. When I leave it out the front where I work, people get a lot of remarks about how people like the look of it, and they think it's great. Now, I'm going to approach this video with the view that it's an electrical problem, and I'm going to start with the electric leads. They're probably the original, and then I'll probably replace the coil. It's fairly old. It seems to have rust on the connections here. This bike hasn't been garaged. It did have a fair amount of, you know, build-up corrosion on the battery, although the battery seems to be good. The front headlight runs bright and it starts first pop. That's a great starter. Okay, I'll start by firing it up cold and just see how it runs. Okay, so the first thing I notice is here, it's cold. It's cold air, and it doesn't seem to be firing. You can hold your finger against the exhaust pipe. And here, there's heat generated, and there's good compression, and it'll blow your finger away. So maybe this cylinder here, and that's the front cylinder, maybe it's not firing at all unless you give it a bit of wick. Okay, the front cylinder. Seems to be firing. There's a white, where is it? Just a white ring around the top of the electrode. So that seems to be okay. Rear cylinder spark plug. That's pretty much fouled up. It doesn't seem to have been firing. It's fairly brown and oily, but the previous owner could have tuned it so that it runs cooler and with, you know, more petrol and less air. Okay, I'll go ahead now and put the original Screaming Eagle spark plugs in. I've adjusted the gap so that it's back to standard. Okay, I've placed the new plugs in. The previous video was taking off with the motorbike with the old plugs in. Now the new plugs are in, and I'll just compare the two, the two spark plugs. Okay, that's a fairly good indication that the spark plugs are part of the problem, and it's a fairly good clue that it's also an electrical problem. So, yeah, I think that's the right direction to go, is to purchase new spark plug leads and a coil. Just as a bit of a sideshow while I'm waiting for the electrical parts to come in, just got to adjust the clutch. It's got a bit of a rough engagement when I put the bike into gear. So that's a lever there. This is the clutch adjustment. And I'll just go ahead and adjust the clutch. That's neutral movement. Starts to engage about there. That's a good 20 mil. So I've just brought that out finger tight until it's tight. You can see there that starts to work as soon as you start to move it. So it's got a fair amount more clutch movement. You can just see the adjustment screw. I'll just point to it with the spanner. It's just down there. Just see, just above the spanner there. You can see there's a fair amount of slackness in the throttle. You need to rev to match your road speed to your gearbox speed, especially to change down. And that confuses the issue a bit, that slackness. So I'm just going to slacken these off, undo the nuts, and just get this a little bit more responsive. Okay, so to bring this nut here further down toward the thread here, gives you more slackness here. And when you screw them away, increase this area here, then you get more tightness on the throttle. So that's pretty tight there. There's no movement. Probably recognised that the throttle was jammed, wouldn't spring back. I've now got snap back with the throttle, and I achieved that just by loosening off here. These nuts on either side were done up a little bit too tight. Okay, this is a 1994 Harley Sportster. Anyone looking for the brake activation switch on a 94 Harley Sportster, that's it just there. Might be able to see that nib there. Okay, so the brake's on full, and just by touching this activation nib here, like that, you can see that the light will go on and off. So by pushing it in, it's dimmed, and to activate it, you just release it like that. So and I'll release it. Okay, so that would be the switch, and there's a small screw behind it just there. So that's the activation switch. That'd be the part behind it, and there's a screw behind there to take it all apart and replace it. Okay, so here's how it works. This normal position is out, and that lights up the stop light and the brake light. Now, you have to. This is in two pieces, that and that part. You have to line it up for this to work. So its normal position is with the light on. That is to say that the brake light is on in the normal position. When you pull the lever in this way, this nib goes in and releases that, and the brake light goes on. Okay, when you're putting your throttle body on against your brake system, there's the light activation switch there. You'll see here, there's a little metal lever. You can see that down there, that it comes away on an angle. So that's it there. A little piece of little piece of steel. That has to line up on the switch there for the rear brake light to work with the front lever and the rear brake lever. Okay, so once you tighten up your throttle body, then that gap there between the switch there on the left and the activation link to the lever, that closes and pushes that activation switch on the left in. Unfortunately, the lever that is supposed to hit the activation switch there, it moves about. Maybe able to see it, I'm not sure. The actual activation switch, I'm able to move it. What that means is that although it can start off hitting the switch, it eventually moves and misses it, so then the rear brake light stays on. Okay, I was able to make it work by bending that lever down. Although you may be able to see that it only just hits the button, and certainly not reliable over the, you know, long term. So to correct that, you'd almost have to buy the brake assembly, probably this part here. Unless you're able to weld a little piece to make it wider on that little arm, but anyway, it works for now. So, it's not working. Okay, I'm a little bit concerned. It's a bit strange how this isn't adjustable. That is to say that this ridge here, this slots into, so that side and that side, they slide into there and there, and you can't adjust that down. As you can see, that slides along in there, and I'm not able to push the lever down at all to line up this lever with the switch. Okay, here you can see the modification I've made. I've put a rivet in the center of the arm that moves, just to extend it out a little bit, and hopefully that'll hit the sensor all the time. Okay, happy days. Just touch the lever and the brake light lights up, as well as the rear brake. Okay, great. So a bit of packing up and I'll call it a day. Okay, so I've just taken it for a quick ride and the symptoms are definitely coughing, spluttering and backfiring. So I've bought a new coil and that'll be the next test to see how the new coil performs. Okay, it's now the 7th of the 12th, 2013. I've got new spark plugs and I've diagnosed it as being electrical. And so on eBay, I've picked up a voltage regulator rectifier, that's that part there, and the coil, that part there, and they're over here. From memory, the coil was around about close to $80, and I think the regulator rectifier around $70. Yeah, so after replacing these two parts, everything's renewed except the wiring and the spark plug leads. So I'll see how I go. Okay, so with the tank pushed back a little bit, there's the coil there. And all I need to do is just undo these two nuts here holding on the wires from the generator. That's the internal, the wires, power going in. The power coming out to the spark plugs are these two outlets here. So I'll just undo these two nuts here, and that's the bracket holding it on. And I'll install the new one. Okay, there's the old on the left, the new on the right. Now I just need to move this bracket over onto the new one. So this metal bracket has thread in it and bolts going through. A really good tip for when you're working above the engine, just cover the cylinder heads with some type of a protective cloth. You've got a hole here and bolts and nuts have a tendency just to jump straight into this hole, and then you've got to dig them out on top of the fins, on top of the head. So just go ahead and place something over the top. Okay, the bracket's installed, and now I'll go ahead and install the wires. Don't forget to label your wires so you know which one is the right side and which one is the left side, that way you don't get them mixed up. The standard spark plug leads fit this new coil, The only thing is I found that you have to actually push them in and then they click in and it's all good. Okay, I'll go ahead and install a new rectifier regulator. Let's see what we've got. We've got a lead running down here. We've got all the connections here underneath. Okay, this is looking from the other side. The bolt on the top, bolt on the bottom, and the connectors here. Okay, so I've undone the connectors. You might be able to see there, that was quite tough to get off. You just push down here on this clutch type mechanism on top, and I was eventually able to release them just by using these grippers on the top bit. That's going to be thrown out anyway because that belongs to the electrical part. Just squeezing down on top there, and that released eventually. And then this one came apart fairly easy, the two prong system into that part there. That's not a very healthy electrical component. I say it's fairly old and worn. That's most probably the cause of my problems. You can see here on the back, it's all sort of that gelatine, hard jelly type structure is all frayed and worn.